Joining us today, I have Dr. Page. She has a passion for integrating faith, multicultural competence, and psychology training, which developed while completing undergraduate studies at Pepperdine University and was further fueled during graduate training at Rosemead School of Psychology at Biola University. Her unwavering charge to return to a Christian graduate school community that values integrating faith into practice while also emphasizing mentorship of minoritized students in the clinical psychology field was fulfilled with her appointment at Regent University. Dr. Page's love of mentorship is continually demonstrated through her roles as NISH mentor for students of color, faculty advisor to the Association of Black Psychologists Student Circle, founder of the Academy of Minority Identity Development and Advocacy, otherwise known as AMIDA, a research team here at Regent University, director of the Campus Psychological Services Center, and just recently, the PsyD program director. Dr. Page, thank you for joining us.
Happy to be here.
Yeah, it's a pleasure to see you.
Yeah.
It's the first time this semester.
I know. I'm week 10. Here we go.
So I've been starting these off can you explain to us where did your interest in psychology first begin and what was that like for you?
Yes. So I feel like I have the kind of traditional psychologist story where like people talk to me and I listened, but I really got interested into it in psychology when I was, I think it was 10th grade. I took a child and adolescent psychology course when I was in high school.
Okay.
And I was fascinated with the themes of attachment and how our caregivers influence how we interact today. And I started seeing that a lot in my relationships with my friends. And I was really curious about that. So I said, okay, I guess I'll study psychology in undergrad. And then I did not know that I needed to keep going to school to be a psychologist. So I learned that about halfway through and then got a little bit of direction about where to go for graduate school and so forth. So that's, as a 10th grade is really how I got started.
Okay. And what is it? So past bachelor's, there's, you know, there's a master's, there's a doctor, there's PhD, PsyD, there's clinical psychology, there's all these different areas of study. What is it that brought you to clinical psychology?
I had a really good mentor when I was in undergrad. So part of my responsibilities when I was at Pepperdine, I was a spiritual life advisor. So I ran Bible studies, essentially, is what happened, but we had a fancy title for it. And I felt like I was using my counseling skills. I was holding confidentiality for girls who were in my dorm. I was, you know, shepherding them in various ways. And I just wanted to be better at it. I wanted to just gain more skills. And so originally, like, I applied to mainly PhD programs, actually, because that if I'm going to get a terminal degree, let's get the PhD, right? Like, let's just go for the moon. But I didn't realize that those programs were more research heavy. And I didn't have a lot of research experience. I was on a big team in undergrad. We did some poster presentations, things like that. But my background wasn't like that of a traditional PhD student. So my mentor actually told me about the PsyD degree in clinical psychology and told me that he thought I would be a pretty good fit for it. So I think if it wasn't for him and his, his encouragement, I guess, his persistent encouragement, I probably wouldn't be here.
And so did you, the PsyD program at Biola, that was, you went in through, after undergrad, you went through graduate school where you got your, was it like a master's in PsyD all in one, kind of like here at Regent?
Yes. Yeah. Funny story. I actually applied to Biola as a PhD student.
So okay.
I was still kind of following that train, but during my interview, they were so kind and they said, you sound more like you kind of want to work with people, maybe do like a little bit of research versus do a lot of research and work with people on the side. And so they allowed me to change the box that I checked, which was really really telling for them about who they are as a program. But
that's cool.
The
master's, that's interesting.
It was awesome. The master's is embedded in the program.
Okay. Yeah. And from my understanding, is Biola, their theoretical orientation is a little bit more psychodynamic than other schools?
Yes, there's a stronger bent towards it. So still evidence-based practice, right? So the foundation of that, but a lot of, when I was there, I had a lot of professors who were there kind of from the beginning times of Rosemead, where psychodynamic and relational and attachment theories were very prevalent, very strong. So I think I got it kind of in every class that I took, some of that understanding.
Okay. So that was probably a really good fit for you already with your high school class and you liking attachment and then going into that.
Yes. Yeah. It was beautiful. I could not have orchestrated it.
So. And is that you, did that propel to now? Is that still your kind of theoretical orientation or what's your leaning like now?
My leaning is probably still more attachment and relational based. I have some, like I still have the psychodynamic lens. So I like to say I was raised kind of in psychodynamic theory, but I would describe myself more attachment oriented.
Okay. And you and Dr. Stevens are planning on starting a psychodynamic class, right? An elective?
Yes, we're reviving it. So Okay. Yes, it used to be here. Dr. Drew Radani had it going on. So it was excellent. I was glad that she was able to bring kind of like a little Rosemead flair to use it. And so we have the opportunity to revive it. So I'm really excited to do that with Dr. Stevens.
Can you tell us a little bit about that?
It's going to be a great time. Everybody should take it. Okay. And so the focus really is going to be on like teaching you guys the theory, the psychodynamic theory, and learning how, teaching you how to conceptualize clients more so from that perspective. So a more focused, I guess, training on it versus just kind of read this book, read this article, and try to make sense of the client that you have right now. Uh-huh. Ideally, I'd like it to become like a, not just a one semester elective, but one that you take all year. And okay. Then you have a client that you work through and present and show tape, things of that sort. But that's...
Is that how it used to be?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that sounds very exciting. I'm excited for that one.
Good.
I'm it glad. Starts in the spring?
Yes, in January.
Okay, good. Yeah. And do you have any... So it can be psychodynamic leaning or whoever. Do you have any kind of psychologist or therapist or just... authors that you really like to, that you pull a lot from or that you would recommend to read?
Oh, that's a good question. Wow. I, for like attachment stuff in PsyD, not so much right now. I'm more kind of immersed in some of the multicultural literature at the moment. So things that talk about like having a multicultural orientation or perspective when working with clients. So having your typical, theoretical orientations, whether it's like attachment, whether it's cognitive behavioral, cognitive theory, but then pulling in all the different salient identities the client has as well to kind of enhance the therapeutic experience. So those are kind of where I hang out now.
Okay. Yeah. What about an author from that category?
Yes. So I have a book actually here.
Okay.
That I can pull out. So Joshua Hook works a lot with Davis, Owen, and De Blair to create this book. It's called Cultural Humility. So learning how to work with clients from that perspective. So that's, it came out in like 2017 and it's one of my favorite books to read. Okay. And talk with students about. I have a new one that I'm using for advanced diversity by Dr. Jones Smith. It's Culturally Diverse Counseling Theory and Practice.
So okay.
I enjoy those a lot.
Good, thank you. Mm-hmm. And so talking about that, how about you, can you tell us a little bit about AMIDA and the startup of that and what you guys do as a research team here at Regent?
Yes, we do a lot of things. so many things. So AMIDA started because I wanted to curate some team that allowed students of color or students who were interested in issues of advocacy and social justice just to have a voice, essentially. I wanted them to have kind of a space and a place throughout their time in the program where they could talk about things that were important to them, that were on their hearts, maybe that didn't feel as safe to bring up in some of the more traditional classes. So that was the foundation of it, essentially. I'm always interested in minority identity development, however that leans and falls. So whether it's racial ethnic identity, gender identity, the intersection of some of those, disabilities, socioeconomic status, all of those things. So from its start, what I've done is students who are interested, they commit for the year and then we talk about kind of themes and we create projects out of those themes. So this year our theme is rest and what it looks like to lean into that and take care of yourself as somebody who is maybe an advocate and kind of on the front lines, but how do you take care of yourself and your soul in the midst of all of that?
That sounds good. Even,
yeah, thank you. Coming off of, last year being not so restful. So
we need it.
Yeah.
And so, well, what kind of, do you guys have any research projects going on right now?
Yes. So we're expanding upon things that we did last year. So one of our third years, Trinity Johnston, had this presentation she gave. It's on like allyship, burnout, and I believe compassion and or compassion fatigue. And so it's more of like a kind of a workshop for people who want to be allies. What does that look like? What are some signs of burnout? And how do you kind of give yourself compassion as an ally when you're hopping into these kind of conversations, but then translating that as well to people who've been in the fight for a little bit. So how do they maybe shore up allyship? How do they protect themselves from burnout? We've looked at what that looks like in therapists of color providing telehealth, people who've been multiply impacted by the pandemic that we're still in. And we've also looked a little bit at what that looks like in kind of educational spaces. So having conversations with students, getting students engaged, and what that looks like from the perspective of individuals of color, of individuals with majority culture, and then also people who ascribe to the Christian faith. So those are kind of our big foci, I guess, right now.
Yeah. That sounds really interesting. This might be a little bit more of a personal question, but can you tell us a little bit about, you can say no, can you tell us a little bit about your maybe identity development, and what is it that got you passionate about helping others with that?
That's a very good question. My identity development started pretty young. So my parents were very intentional on making sure that I, as a young little Black girl growing up, going to schools that were predominantly white, that I believed in myself. So growing up, I was always aware of my ability and aptitude to perform well in academics, at least. My parents weren't extremely intelligent. So it was always, you know, do your best, whatever your best is, but we know what you're capable of. So make sure that you always reach those heights. And so I think kind of merging that with what it meant to be a woman and also a woman of color kind of transpired around high school-ish, but mainly in undergrad and graduate school. I don't know. I've always just been really interested in it. So like my high school was all girls.
Okay.
So that was great for me. It's like, oh, great. Like we're just going to school. Like we're not worried about like relationships. Like we show up, there's no makeup. People aren't shaving their legs. Like we are here to learn. And I value that so much.
Yeah.
And when I switched to going to undergrad, it was co-ed. And it was just interesting to see how people could, I guess, just help. Their focus was a little bit different. So some people were there really trying to, you know, get married by the time they graduated, and others were, okay, like, this is my degree. This is what I'm here for. And so I was curious about what that looks like in different gender presentations as well. So graduate school, I don't know. I think it all kind of came together. We didn't talk a lot about intersectionality when I was in graduate school,
okay.
But I recognized that I had so many different pieces in my life that came together in such a way that encouraged me and told me that I like could do what I wanted to do. So I was curious about exploring that.
You've told me before about after graduate school and kind of your plans and how you ended up at Regent. Can you kind of talk a little bit about that?
Oh my God. Oh, it was a complete God thing, 100%. So halfway through graduate school, I decided, okay, so like maybe I'll just stay in Kansas, right? Like it'll be fine. Work here for a couple of years, get some loan repayment. But Kansas was not the place for me. It was not life-giving at all. It was more of like a really long wilderness experience, unfortunately. But I think it helped me get to where I am. So I went through like multiple rounds of kind of postdoc applications. It was like, oh, I like students. Let's go to UCC. That didn't work out. Okay, I'll just go back to California, right? Like I'll work for Biola for a little bit. I'll do this private practice. But none of those options really felt like completely fulfilling. I didn't want to be in multiple locations. I really wanted to make sure that I was working with a body of people who believed in training students and training them to be competent and excellent clinically. So Regent fell into my lap, actually. So Dr. Driverdani reached out to one of my cohort mates who then called me and was like, hey, Regent's hiring, you should apply. It's like, what is Regent? I've heard of it. What are you talking about? Oh, it's in Virginia, like across the country?
Yeah.
California? That's not for me. No, never. So I ended up applying. I was forced to apply. So I ended up doing it, and I didn't think that, I think it would go farther, right? I was like, they'll read my things and be like, who is this child? PsyD, we don't want it, right? And I ended up coming out for the interview, meeting everybody, and walking on campus after I had my job talk. So I talked about my dissertation. It felt like I was at home. Mm. And I couldn't, it was a palpable feeling that I had. I remember I went on the campus tour and some students who were in the job talk like chased after me and I was like, what is going on? But it was like, you know, they told me like, I feel like you're here for such a time as this. Like, thank you so much for coming. And we really hope you were able to stay. And so I get like chills every time I think about it.
Yeah,
but
I just got chills.
Yeah. It's just, I didn't recognize the impact that I could potentially have. And so I said, okay, well, I feel like God wants me to be here and the students seem to like me. So
what was your job talk on?
What was it? My dissertation title was so long. The professional influences on the personal and professional identity development of the Black female psychologist.
Mm, okay, good.
So, yeah, just intersectionality of the wazoo, essentially.
Yeah. And how long has it been since you've walked on campus?
That's May of June, early June of 2014.
Okay.
7 years.
And so, let's see. And now, okay. And so now you just got promoted to, you know, director.
I did.
And
yes.
where do you see kind of your, maybe in like the next 10 years, where do you see yourself being if you had to imagine? I know you would have never even thought that you'd be director by now, right? I don't
no.
know.
Maybe,
so.
No, and here I am.
Yeah. Well, what is your, I guess, you know, what is your goal? What does your future look like to you?
Oh, wow. I don't know. I see myself still at Regent functioning in some capacity. So in every role that I've had, I feel like I have worked hard to make it better than it was before I stepped into it. So I've kind of transitioned from each position feeling like, okay, like I did my job, right? Good. Like the goals that I had were there and they were accomplished. So even this transition happening a little bit earlier than I thought it might, I still feel pretty solid in what I was able to accomplish as clinic director. So as program director, there's a lot to do. Like there's so many aspects of the program that I would like to shift a little bit and see changed. So like ideally I would like every student to graduate and be happy that they graduated from here. I have like fond memories, right?
That'd be great.
Not like, oh, it was so hard. I'm so tired, right? Like, I don't want to think about psychology. So I would like positive associations to be with our program. And then from there, I think I'd like us to have a stronger like national presence. So when people hear Regent, they think of the PsyD program, what we've accomplished.
Yeah.
So, but beyond that, I haven't thought too much further.
Yeah. Oh, that's good. And stepping away from future-oriented.
Yes.
If you could look from the beginning of your career up until now, what would you say the most maybe impactful or rewarding experience that you had was?
The most? Like one? Oh, dear. oh my gosh. I need to, okay. Okay, so I have two. Which is not your question, but I'll get to
you. What are the two most?
The two most. Thank you. Great. Okay, good. So on internship, my site supervisor, Jeremy Morris, was entirely instrumental in helping me develop my voice.
Mm.
So one-on-one, like we've had conversations one-on-one. And so who I am now was not who I was when I was on internship.
Uh-huh.
I hid my personality a lot because it didn't feel professional. And I didn't know how I could effectively work with clients in that way. And so he would encourage me to be myself fully. And he would, every time I didn't show up, like, he's like, where's the rest of Cassandra? I need her to be here. So with that, Oh, he was great. But it was the first time I had somebody who was in power and also white, actually, who was not afraid, I guess, of all that means for me to be a Black woman. So he was like, yeah, be sassy, be sarcastic, do that. It's like, are you sure? Like, are you okay?
Do you know what you're asking for?
Right, exactly. Like, that really helped me, I think, come into my own tremendously. And so I was able to build upon that when I came to Regent. And since being here, the second, so Jeremy fought for my voice. And then I would say, I think Dr. D and Dr. Y both fought for me as person. I guess. So it was instrumental for me to have a woman of color that I could look to, like, okay, you've been through it, right? Like you made it, you got tenure. What did you need to do to get there? How did you survive? And also you're thriving. So what does that look like for you? Like, what boundaries have you set up? And so she allowed me to be human, but also reminded me of the strength that I had. And Dr. Yarhouse was very instrumental in like the relational piece of it, I think, and reminded me that like you as a person, like you, Cassandra, are also very important. So yes, you teach, that's great. Yes, you mentor, that's great. But like, how are you actually doing in his intentionality and making sure that he and his wife, making sure that I was okay, that I was provided for, that I felt, you know, cared for and protected. I think those pieces were really instrumental, in, I think, keeping me here and making me who I am today.
I have, I was just thinking, so all of those, I guess when I was going to ask that question, I was wondering if there's something that you have done or maybe working with a client or like this. So I like that. It's interesting. All of those both answers have to do with you being at the receiving end. Right. And having those mentors and you being so interested in mentorship and wanting to kind of give back, I think that's really cool.
Yeah.
Thank you. It's interesting.
Yeah.
And so there's hearsay that that you're looking into writing a book or something like that.
Oh my God. Talking to each other. Jeez. Oh, the grapevine. Yeah, I would love to write a book. I would like. I would love to. I have chapters written down over here on my desk right here. So
good.
She's my accountability partner right now. I don't have a title.
Okay.
I don't have a title at all. But so my dissertation, I wrote it because I felt like it would be a good tool for people who looked like me, also pursuing a terminal degree, as a reminder, like, you're not the only one, right? Like, somebody has done this. We thought about you. These are things that probably you're going to be experiencing. So like, just keep on, like, you're going to make it, you'll be fine. So I've always felt this kind of responsibility to give back to people, right? To make things easier for them if they're following me in some way, shape or form. Yeah. And so my book idea is a little bit similar, to more so along the lines of being a person of color, being a woman in academia, what it looks like to experience sort of like micro and macroaggressions and how I've kind of responded to them. So
yeah,
it feels like it's going to be more of a memoir, and I hope people want to read it.
Yeah. No, I think that'll be good. So I found a lot of my mentorship through authors. I do a lot of reading, and I think that comes from when I started. I didn't really read much until my early 20s, and I was over in Japan and I didn't have a lot of people to really look up to. And so I found books. And for you, I'm sorry, I forget what her name was, your mentor that really helped you find who you are.
Dr. D?
Yeah, Dr. Yeah. D. So, yeah. So if you had not had her, so a book like this for someone, for another person going through a program, if they don't have you around, or if they don't have someone, you know, that then maybe they can come across your book, and that's a great way to find mentorship, I think. So I think that it's needed, and I hope that you write it.
All right. Okay. I'm trying. All right.
with all of your free time.
Yes, all the free time. Yeah.
I guess last, I was just going to ask, I know it's been a wild ride, and even from, you know, California to Virginia, coming to Regent, and then your time here. Is there anything looking back that you wish you could have changed or done differently, or?
Not really. I think, I think steps of my story make sense looking back. I wish I had been able to find my voice earlier. I'm curious about how I, what that would have looked like. What it would look like for me, but no, I think everything happened the way it was supposed to.
Yeah, I'll tell you, you're, I remember our first semester with you, we had psychopathology. Yeah. And everyone just loved you. And the, a lot of the big reason that they loved you is because of your personality. And I think you having your voice. And so I can't imagine Dr. Page before that happened.
Yeah, you wouldn't have recognized her. Okay. It wouldn't have been very, like, we talk about being congruent people, right? Like not kind of siphoning pieces of ourselves off. And so I didn't know how to kind of, merge them. So I'm glad that I'm more congruent individual than I was when I started graduate school.
Yeah. I read about a it was a quote from a psychoanalyst who was talking about institutes, and he was saying that we get all these smart and bright people, all these people with all these different backgrounds and personalities, and then they come to the institute and they think that they have to learn this technique or this intervention, and that they have to follow the exactly the way that it's, and then it says, it's a shame that there's not more of their personalities involved, or that there's not more with the therapeutic relationship being the most kind of important aspect, that there's not a whole lot of research on different personality styles in therapy. And I thought that was really interesting. And I think someone with you, like your personality type, I think that that would just, that's already just a great, a great added bonus or piece for you to conduct therapy, I would imagine.
Thank you. I hope so. Yeah. My clients seem to enjoy it.
Good.
So.
Good.
Working.
Yeah.
Thank you. Appreciate that.
Well, Dr. Page, thank you for sharing with us today. I really enjoyed it. I always love hearing your story. Your story, just, you couldn't have ever dreamt it up, you know? It's all fallen into place.
Yeah, it has. So there's a creator. Orchestrating. I'm just following. I could not have drawn this out better myself. So yeah, happy to share.
Thank you.
You're welcome.